Spuler, who is head of the department in university outpatient clinic for muscle disease at the Charité in Berlin, and she's also senior group leader at the Max Delbrück Center for Molecular Medicine in Berlin. She is an educated clinician, I believe, studied medicine at the University of Würzburg, worked as a neurologist and is an MD, did her PhD then at the Max Planck Institute on multiple sclerosis in Würzburg, did then a stay in the US at UCSD as a postdoc, where she focused more on basic science, came then back to Germany as a clinician in neurology, that was in Großhadern in Munich, also worked at the Max Planck Institute for neurobiology, Martin Ried. Then went back again to the US, to the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, where she learned all the techniques, I think, that are now applied in the diagnosis of muscle diseases. She then joined or formed her own group in Berlin, and since then has focused on various aspects of muscle disease, but with a key focus on muscle dystrophy. Therefore, I think Simone is a great example for how to combine clinical and basic research and really try to bring new approaches to the clinic. She's also very vocal towards the public, where she's frequently featured now in particularly German-speaking media, to both raise awareness as well as money for her preclinical work on muscle diseases. She's also here today to participate at the Health Science Forum in Vienna, which is organized by IMBA and Merck together, where she will share her insights on how mRNA revolutionizes medicine, and that's also what she will talk about today in her scientific talk, where she will tell us about new frontiers of drug development in muscular dystrophy and the impact of the new mRNA technology in this area. Thanks a lot for coming. Very much looking forward to your presentation.
Thank you very much for this very friendly introduction, and thank you for the invitation to Vienna. Last time I was in Vienna was about 12 years ago, and it's always very nice to come back, but I am more often in Austria because we just love Salzburg, and this is where we have a little place, and so I do spend quite a bit of my time in Austria. Okay, so today I want to talk about muscular dystrophies and mRNA. Can you hear me well? I have not switched on the microphone. Okay, so we leave it. Why is this not moving? Okay, the topic of the interest of my group are muscular dystrophies. And muscular dystrophies are a group of severe devastating disorders, and there are about 50 different very severe disorders. Each of them caused by a different gene, and all of these diseases are monogenic disorders. Each of these diseases is rare, they are orphan diseases, so the research around, or particularly the therapy-oriented research around these diseases has been quite limited, but you may be aware of the fact that the legal instruments in basically all countries in the Western world at least have now facilitated the market approval for drugs for orphan diseases, and now there is a lot of energy now in bringing therapies for orphan disorders to the market. So overall, we have about a quarter of a million patients in the EU and US who are suffering from these muscular dystrophies. And today, the standard of care is palliative support that can include respiratory support or medication for heart failure, of course, physical therapy. But for none of the muscular dystrophies, there's anything close to a causative therapy yet. The disease, all of these disorders lead to the rebuilding of skeletal muscle from a healthy organ that you can see here on the left, where you see healthy muscle fibers that are basically similar in size and have this polygonal shape, and over time muscle gets replaced by fat and connective tissue. movement looks like that on the right, and once muscle looks like this, there's no way to return this course. So it is mandatory to interfere if there is any chance at all, and to interfere as early as possible. So from our what we do in Berlin, we have the university outpatient clinic, and it's quite large. We have we take care of about 2,500 patients with different all kinds of muscle disorders, also acquired ones. And then we started to be interested in the muscle stem cell. For about 10 years we have been working on this, and I will talk about the muscle stem cell because this is really instrumental to understand what we are thinking, why and how mRNA could be useful. And then of course I will talk about the mRNA. So the muscle stem cell is called satellite cell, and the reason why it's called satellite cell is the anatomical location. And a muscle fiber is a multinucleated cell with hundreds of nuclei, and the muscle fiber is surrounded by the sarcolemma, and all the nuclei are obviously inside the sarcolemma, but the satellite cell is located between the sarcolemma and the basal lamina. The cell was detected about 60 years ago by Alexander Mauro, who also was instrumental in inventing and finding the cardiac pacemaker. He was in New York and got a little bored, and so at night he was in the lab, and he studied guinea pig muscle, and he found a cell that was located at a different location in muscle than the regular nuclei. And he called this the cell satellite cell, and I'm so amazed by this article, the 60-year-old article, that he writes in his introduction as a third sentence. So the cells might indeed be of interest to the students, sure, and of muscle histology, and furthermore, as we shall suggest, might be pertinent to the vexing problem of skeletal muscle regeneration. And this is such a smart and genius sentence, because he was completely right, but the scientific community did not understand that this was right for the next 50 years, and I will explain this a little bit. So it was clear that the cell exists, and the hypothesis has already been formulated, but it took forever. But although there was not so much understanding of the satellite cell, of the nature of the satellite cell, of the molecular characteristics of the satellite cell, but of course there was after it became clear that it's possible to isolate cells that grow from skeletal muscle, the idea of transplanting healthy cells to a diseased muscle came up quite early, and in this Nature paper from 1989, Terry Partridge and Kunkel in Boston, they showed that you can indeed, in a mouse model for muscular dystrophy, transplant successfully some muscle cells into diseased muscle. And this led, and this must be said a little bit unfortunate, this led to a very quick clinical trial that succeeded this initial animal experiments. And here in the New England Journal of Medicine, which you probably know is like the mecca of clinical papers, and here you can see a myoblast transfer and the treatment of Duchenne muscular dystrophy. This was an allogeneic setting, so healthy donors gave the cells to diseased boys with Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Mm-hmm. And this clinical trial completely failed. So there was no integration of this host, of the donor cells into a host, and and it sort of ruined the entire field of cell therapy in muscle wasting disorders, because it was so prominently published, and a lot of hope had been put into this project. And so one must say the myoblast satellite cell transplantation failed so far. And why was that? So the boys who received these cells, they also received some immunosuppressant agents. They got cortisone, there still was an immune response against the transplanted cells in this allogeneic setting. The cells simply didn't survive. There was apoptosis. The cells that were transplanted, they did not enter the stem cell niche. They just didn't home anywhere. And so they were also not able to self-renew. There was no migration from the injection site. And the regenerative capacity was simply not shown in the cells that were transplanted. It was not even clear whether the cells were myogenic that were transplanted. This could as well have been fibroblasts. There were simply no markers that could identify these cells. So unfortunately, this was really difficult for this therapy field. And people then in the next 15 years, they started to look for cells that might have some myogenic potential, so might be helpful to make muscle because the satellite cells sort of had failed. And here I don't want to go in very much detail through all these different cells, but some of them definitely will sound familiar to you, like the iPS cells. So even today there's a lot of hope that from induced pluripotent stem cells, it will be able to make a normal muscle cell, a muscle stem cell. And there are the CD133 cells that can also be isolated from blood. There are the mesenchymal stem cells. But all of these cells, they do support the making of muscle, but they do not make muscle by themselves. They are adjuvant cells, they make cytokines that definitely support the new building of muscle, but it took until 2011 when these three papers came out from three different groups in France and also in the States that definitely showed when you do not have satellite cells, you will not have any muscle regeneration. And so from the day when Alexander Mauro wrote his paper in 61 until 2011, there were 50 years it took until it finally became clear that you do need these satellite cells. This was about the time when I had the chance to start with my own group in Berlin, and I just found this really fascinating and interesting, and thought, okay, now all of these papers were done in transgenic animal models, where the PAX7 had a conditional knockout, and so there were possibilities to play around with certain transcription factors important for satellite cells. And but nobody until then had looked at satellite cells in human muscle. And now I'm a clinician, as you know, and so this was quite close to my thinking to look at diagnostic muscle biopsies that we take anyway and see whether how the satellite cells are behaving. Now, since the satellite cell became so important and so popular in research, there were a lot of molecules that are now able to characterize the satellite cell, and you can see here different transcription factors and also surface molecules. But the only transcription factor that is really defining the quiescent satellite cell in the stem cell niche is PAX7. So PAX7 is the most relevant transcription factor for this type of cell. And the surface markers, of course, are very interesting when you want to purify them and sort them by FACS. But none of these surface markers is really specific for the cell. And the satellite cell behaves like a true stem cell. So the signal that it gets activated is an injury to the muscle fiber, and once there is the activation of the satellite cell, the muscle fiber fuses with the activated satellite cell, so the satellite cell contributes to the multinucleated muscle fiber, but then there is also a proportion of the cells that go back into quiescence and repopulate the stem cell niche. So this is what characterizes like the true stem cell. And as you can see down here, there is this whole process of activation, going back into quiescence and contributing to the fiber is defined by an array of different transcription factors that are expressed and be shut down again. But I don't think that you need to remember this in detail. So the problem problem why these cells were not usable yet for therapy. Well, first of all, because one didn't know in earlier times how to characterize these cells. And then if you want to purify these cells, the protocol that is used by most groups is you take the skeletal muscle tissue and then you do a digest with collagenase, dispase, all these enzymes. And these enzymes cause an activation of a premature activation of the satellite cell. And when you put them in culture, the problem is that the satellite cell proliferates quite a few times, but rapidly it differentiates or goes into senescence, and you are simply not able to get a large number of these cells. So one of the most important things we thought after we got some hold on where the cells are and how frequent they are in adult skeletal muscle, we invented a new method how to expand these muscle stem cells. And here the magic about this new method, the magic is that we put the piece of muscle for an entire week in the fridge. We don't do anything else, it's just the refrigerator. But what happens after the muscle biopsy is taken, we do a manual preparation of the little fragments, and then the satellite cells they stay in their physiological niche, and then by putting these cells into hypothermia, they sort of go back into quiescence and they do not start this premature proliferation. And after 1 week, we take these cells out again, and then we do a very regular cultivation at 37 degrees, and we get really nice and long-living colonies. So here you see a little muscle biopsy specimen. So this is about the size of my little fingertip, and we never take more muscle than this, even when we think about some therapeutic applications. Then we do a step of manual dissection, and I'm not sure whether this will run, but you can see that these little fragments still have their satellite cells and that they are quite active and mobile on the fiber, and this is what they do physiologically anyway, so they sort of guard the fiber and see whether there's any injury. And so here this is a staining of a fiber where you can appreciate that myogenic cells that are defined by Desmin, that they proliferate inside of this fiber fragment and that they all express this transcription factor PAX7. Okay, now I'm telling you that our method, this is hypothermic treatment, really improves the quality of the cells, and you may or may not believe that, and we had to prove this, of course, by transplantation experiments. One of the really nice things about this method is that this hypothermia is so harsh on the tissue that all of the rest of the cells, the fibroblasts, the adipocytes, the endothelial cells, everything else that is in skeletal muscle, does not survive this week, and only myogenic cells can be purified out of this. And here on the left, you can see we have 100% Desmin and we have a lot of PAX7 positive very early cells. And when we do transplantation experiments in mice that are lacking immune system, so we have here the NOG mice, we see human muscle fibers that are built, hundreds of these fibers, and we also see a repopulation of the satellite cell niche, as you can see here in one of the examples. And of course, as you may believe, the reviewers asked for more. They also wanted to know whether true regeneration after another muscle injury is possible. And here we show that you can transplant the cells, they make new muscle, and then you injure the muscle with a cardiotoxin, which is a very famous toxin that sort of destroys muscle completely, and then we could show that again muscle regenerates and also the stem cell niche is repopulated. So by then we were quite convinced that we can try to go into clinic using these cells by repairing maybe a very small muscle to begin with and as a proof of concept. And we thought about a disease that affects, that is a congenital disorder of the bladder sphincter. So little children are affected, the disease is called dysbardia. And when we came up with this idea to treat very small children with an incomplete muscle sphincter, so we have a pediatric indication, our regulatory agencies, the Paul Ehrlich Institute, they immediately wanted more proof. Of course, they wanted a whole bunch of safety studies, toxicity, tumorigenicity, biodistribution, all of that. But they also wanted another functional test. And so here you can see quite a cool experiment that we had to pay a lot of money for because we weren't able to do this technically. So here we have an athymic rat, and the rat had got a telemetry introduced to the bladder. And then the sphincter of the rats was injured, and the bladder pressure was measured continuously. And for repair, they received these cells, our cells, and we could, to our surprise, see that indeed these cells led to a very good and very fast repair of the sphincter muscle. So this convinced the Paul Ehrlich Institute, and now we are starting, or we have started, the first clinical trial using these cells, and they are this sort of medication is called an ATMP, Advanced Therapeutic Medicinal Product, which a term that has been coined in 2007 when cell therapies became clear that this will become a new group. And here, because we are dealing with children, we have some patient information written for drawn for children, and so the problem is that these children who are suffering from this rare disease, dysbardia, that they will remain incontinent for the rest of their life, and there's really nothing that can be done by surgery or medication. So this repair by doing cell transplantation may be the only possibility these children can have. Boys are more affected than girls in about 6 to 1. And a colleague, a pediatric urologist, his name of Kai Bafzadeh, he has tried to do this similarly, but he didn't have this technique of purifying these cells so well. But he has shown that there can be an effect of this injection, and he showed in 5 children that they became incontinent after treatment. We have financing for this trial from the MBF, Federal Ministry of Research and Education, and as I said, we just got the ethical vote, and so everything is okay, and the recruitment of the patients is ready, so we can really get started. And this is like the little bit more professional way to show this. So here, this is a bladder sphincter, and there is a defect in the muscle, in the striated muscle surrounding of the sphincter, and this is the spot where these cells will become injected. Okay, now I'm not a urologist and I don't want to turn into one, so now we are more interested in the muscular dystrophies. And when we were basically ready to start our first clinical trial or to do our planning for the first clinical trial, there was CRISPR came up, and immediately we understood, well, now we have the cells, and this technique of CRISPR-Cas will maybe really add to the speed and to the efficiency how we can deal with mutations that cause muscular dystrophy. So CRISPR-Cas, I'm sure that here in the Molecular Biology Institute, I really don't need to explain this, but there are different tools now available. There is this classical CRISPR-Cas9 as a nuclease that causes a DNA double-strand break, and the repair of this double-strand break is in non-dividing cells that can be homology dependent repair with a template, very nice but quite inefficient so far. Non-homologous end joining as like a random process of indel insertion is also a possibility, but for complete gene repair, this first didn't really seem to be so suitable. We were not talking about knockouts here, but we were aiming for doing a precise gene repair, and we weren't quite sure whether we could start or whether we could get any good results here with NHEJ approach. Then there is a base editor for the cytidine and also the adenine deamination, and more recently the prime editing has been introduced. Prime editing basically or theoretically allows to focus on every single mutation, but also here the efficiency of the editing is quite low. There has been a little bit of improvement, but I don't think I would call this a breakthrough. Okay, but then we got started, and the first question we had to ask is whether our great technique with a fridge, whether this technique also would allow us to get really nice and pure cell populations from patients who are suffering from muscular dystrophy, because there are a lot of fibroblasts, and these fibroblasts, they tend to be to overgrow cell cultures quite malignantly, but indeed, even from muscular dystrophy patients, we can get very pure and very nice cell populations, and here the desmin is 95%, so it's close to 100. The PAX7 is preserved as an early transcription factor with almost 70%. The cells proliferate, as we can see with Ki67, and then other myogenic markers are also expressed. And these cells are taken from children who are suffering from muscular dystrophy caused by mutations in SGCA. This stands for alpha-sarcoglycan. And this disease is as severe as Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, but affects girls and boys equally. And here we have a compound heterozygous mutation, one in exon 7 and one in exon 2. And when we try to make these decisions, which patient to make project on, and how can we deal with this? So first, of course, it needs to be feasible, and with the instruments that we can use, it needs to be targetable, but also we are quite interested in the fact whether these mutations have been published before and whether there is a community of patients who would eventually profit from therapy. And here these two mutations that I was showing here in exon 2 and exon 7, they both had been published before, and in both of them it became clear that no alpha-sarcoglycan is made. And so here we started this project, and it turned out that the exon 2 mutation, the 157G2A, is an ideal candidate for the adenine base editor. So the adenine base editor, the Cas9 is inactivated, so it doesn't act as a nuclease anymore. The TATA enzyme is added, and here it's only a sugar moiety that is exchanged, and a DNA double-strand break is not created by the by the base editor. So from a clinical point of view, it's more safer to go for a base editor approach than for the classical Cas9. However, the base editor is quite picky in how the constellation around the mutation needs to be. So when we talk about an NGG pump, which was back then available, but here in this mutation we had a perfect NGG pump close to the activity window, and this needs to be a very defined distance that cannot be changed, and the activity window can only have a single adenine. If there is another adenine, then of course this will be edited as well, and we only create a new problem. So here we had this ideal candidate, and we started with a plasmid-based approach. Helena Escobar in my group, she set all of this up, and to repair the first mutation took us almost 2 years. Now it's much faster, but back then we were just, we were trying to get a hand on this. So here we have a plasmid that has as a reporter molecule the Venus, and we did a FAC sort, so we had only transfected cells available, and here the SG RNA and the base editor are all in the same, cloned into the same plasmid. But you can see here that in this plasmid-based approach, we have a 50-50 distribution of the G and the A, because the patient is compound heterozygous, and after the editing step, we have 100% G and 0 A, This is by Sanger sequencing, but this has been confirmed by amplicon sequencing and next generation sequencing. So we have really made sure that this is not exaggerated, and we saw this really nice and high editing efficiency. Now the cells, once they are edited, they could be basically dead and not do anything anymore, and so we wouldn't be even thinking about using this for further treatment development. But here you can see that these muscle cells, they fuse really nicely after repair. Here we have the control with the sarcoglycan in green. The patient's myotubes, multinucleated cells, do not express any protein, but here the repaired cells, they have sarcoglycan in normal distribution and also in the amount of protein that is expressed. And when we take these cells and ask whether they are still able to make new muscle fibers and whether they are able to repopulate the stem cell niche, yes, indeed they are. And here you can see alpha-sarcoglycan positive human muscle fibers in this mouse model, and also satellite cells that do express alpha-sarcoglycan. And I think this is really the first time that a muscle stem cell has been repaired and located to the right spot. So this was definitely something we wanted to pursue further. However, with plasmid-based approaches, we can never enter the clinic. You know, the plasmids, they can be thrown out of the cell, they can integrate into the DNA, they are long-lived, and you know, who wants to have a nuclease, Cas molecule in their genome? So we needed to find another way to have a short-lived molecule where we can deliver the CRISPR tools and the mRNA therapeutics. This was before the vaccines came out that we started this. Just want to mention this. But they are all now well known as, you know, mRNA-based vaccines, as we all know. mRNA-based tumor therapy is going to become very important, and now the mRNA-based gene therapy, where we focus on. When we started to look at the mRNA, we started very simple and very primitively, and just had mRNA that encoded GFP, and we looked whether primary muscle stem cells would even be able to take them up, and how well they survive, and how well how the dosages need to be. And you can see that when we transfect a plasmid in these primary human cells, and we get this smear of some cells that are quite positive, others that are more dull. But with the mRNA, these muscle stem cells, they just love it and take it up, and we get this dose-dependent, very nice and well-defined sharp peaks. And you can see here in the expression that all of the cells express the equal amount of GFP, and that there is not this uneven distribution that we always have seen with the plasmids. Now the cells that are taken from patients, of course, they are very, very valuable, and usually we don't have hundreds of millions of them. And so when we establish, you know, a new method in how to deal with mRNA-based based gene editing in cells, we needed to find a model or test model that easily allows us to screen cells for editing success, but that also that we wouldn't use up these valuable cells of our patients. And there was NCAM, NCAM-1, that came just handy. NCAM is a surface molecule, it's a neural associated molecule, and this is expressed on the surface and can easily be detected by FACS, whereas all the other myogenic markers like Desmin or PAX7, they are all intracellular and are a little bit more awkward to work with on FACS. So here we said, okay, we have NCAM. NCAM is expressed on all muscle cells, and here we can play around with different CRISPR tools, mRNA based, and see whether how they work and how they cut and how we can optimally transfect these cells and all of this. So here this is an example of a classical Cas9, where we just knock out the NCAM gene, and you can see here that this really works very nicely and very efficiently. So here by FACS, we they are all positive for MCAM, and after transfection with this mRNA mediated Cas9, we have almost 100% knockout in these primary cells, but these cells are healthy from a healthy donor. So this works really nicely, and we also did the same thing on a different location in the gene for the adenine base editor to establish this, and also here we can find a more than 90% conversion from adenine to guanine here in exon 7 model site, but we used all of this to establish these new way of gene editing. And the mutation I was showing you before that can be repaired by the base editor, here is now shown with the mRNA mediated base editor, and also here we can see quite nice at high editing efficiency, so we are, I think, here in a very promising way. Now after editing, of course, an important question is whether these cells still grow, whether they can survive, and whether they behave still like myogenic cells, and you can see that the editing step, we do this with electroporation, so traditionally this is seen as being very toxic to the cells, but you can see here that for 2 days the cells sort of lack any further growth, but then they restart growing exponentially like the untransfected cells that are here shown in the hatched line. And also the mRNA does not do any harm to the myogenic properties. We have still a pure desmin positive cell population. The cells still grow, they express a Ki67, they have the myogenic transcription factors and they fuse, so we can be quite happy about the outcome. Mm-hmm. Now this is the base editor, and but not many mutations can be addressed by the base editor, and we were wondering whether we can do with a classical Cas9, whether we can do any useful things in terms of exact gene repair. And now I have two examples for you: one where I would say it works so la la, and the other one where I'm a little bit happier about. So first I show you the one where I would say, yeah, it works so la-la. This is a founder mutation in a gene that is called dysferlin. Dysferlin causes limb girdle muscular dystrophy 2B. It's also one of the more frequent limb girdle muscular dystrophies and also quite a severe one. And there's a founder mutation, exon 44, where a G is deleted, and the official mutation nomenclature is given here. So the deletion of the one G causes a premature stop codon in the mRNA of dysferlin, and when we cut with the classical Cas9, we can induce a reframing of the dysferlin. So there is a little bit on a more distant side, there is an A insertion in the dysferlin gene with a very high and very nice efficiency. So this is quite nice, but what we see is this plus one insertion on a more distant side to the mutation, but we still see that four amino acids are different from the wild type sequence. And this, of course, is very important to find out whether this will be of any harm to the patient, or whether this is even usable, or whether we need to find different approaches. So at least one possibility to address this would be to look whether the dysferlin protein is expressed in the cells. And you can see here the dysferlin is also a membrane protein, that indeed in these repaired cells you can see the dysferlin protein expressed on the sarcolemma, whereas in the unedited myotubes, in the unedited patient cells, there is no dysferlin whatsoever. There are also some in vitro functional tests that can be done. I would be careful here to push this approach so much further, but I wanted to show this example because at least one can see that with a classical CRISPR-Cas9, we can find targeted and repeatable editing that is not just random indels. And another example where I think this is quite nice and quite convincing is another muscular dystrophy, which is called muscular dystrophy 2A. There it is a calpain 3 protein that is not expressed, and the mutation is in calpain 3 gene. This group of muscular dystrophy is quite frequent, and here we also have a founder mutation that affects more than 20% of all patients with this particular type of muscular dystrophy. When we look at our population in our outpatient clinic, we have about 40% of our patients with LGMD2A are suffering from the single C550del A mutation, which of course makes a good point to work on this mutation, because worldwide there are almost 10,000 patients who are affected by this single mutation. Calpain is a very difficult protein to work with, because it's a half-time of a few minutes, and every try to isolate this protein to even find out what it's used for in the cell is quite difficult and full of artifacts. When you go through the literature, there are so many attempts, but nothing where you can really be sure that this is right what you are reading. So it's a protease, and this 550 del A mutation is quite frequent. And we selected three patients where we tried to do a repair of this 550 del A. First, in our work line, we make iPS cells from a single patient. So then we have iPS cells where we have unlimited number of cells, and we can use this as a tool to establish our guide RNAs, to optimize about guide RNAs. But eventually it comes to the point where we take our primary cells and where we try to do this repair. And here we have two patients that are carrying a homozygous mutation. Here we have the AC, and here this is wild type AA. And so two patients that were included in this initial study with a homozygous mutation, and one patient with a heterozygous mutation. And in all of them, the calpain was completely missing by Western blot. And here we found that with a specific guide RNA that we now call guide RNA 1, it doesn't really matter, that with a specific guide RNA we could again and again repeatedly do a correct mutation with an insertion of a single A without any other indels that were caused by this guide RNA, and the repair to a double A in this position. So this is patient 1, patient 2, and patient 3. This double A was the only mutation that was induced, and was also induced with a very high frequency. And the protein, the calpain protein, was re-expressed, and the cells were nice and healthy. And so this probably happens because the Cas9, although Cas9 usually does a blunt DNA double-strand break, but under certain conditions that depend on the sequence and also on the guide RNA, under certain conditions Cas9 induces a staggered cut. And this is apparently what has happened here in this very frequent mutation, so that we get this staggered cut and the insertion of exactly a single A at the staggered cut site, which is quite interesting. It has been described before, but nobody has ever thought about making any clinical use of this. And so we think this is quite nice. And also here, when we think about double-strand breaks, we also need to be concerned about any safety issues. And we have here, by amplicon sequencing and prediction tools, we have screened 60 different sites for the possibility of an off-target event, and we couldn't identify any. So we would say that this staggered cut, single cut approach for this mutation would be something that we can take into a first clinical trial. And this is now, when I come to the end, summarizes what we have in mind. So we do have the muscle stem cells now well characterized and also produced in a pharmaceutical environment. And we want to go with mRNA-based precise gene editing, in these cells. We want to do transplantation in autologous manner in these patients, and we call this a basket trial because we will include different genes, as I showed you, dysferlin, calpein, and alpha-sarcoglycan, and transplant the corrected cells back to the patients. So here I'm still I still don't have all the money we need to do the trial, but we are on a good way, and I think we can start next year with this first clinical trial. And of course, this will only correct a few muscles when we transplant these cells, if it works at all. But we need to have a long-term vision, and this would of course be in vivo correction using the same tools. And for this, we made in the last years very useful tools, and these are humanized mouse models for the same genes I have been talking about. So here the frequent alpha-sarcoglycan mutation, the founder mutation in dysferlin, and the founder mutation in calpein. And what we did, or we, means that Ralf Kuhn, who is the head of the transgenic animal facility at the MDC in Berlin, he took out the human gene, replaced it with he took out the mouse gene, replaced it with human sequence, and now we have really wonderful animal models where we can use exactly the same guide RNAs and exactly the same tools to try to go into this in vivo editing. And this is what I foresee, that we can encapsulate the mRNA with a molecule, not with a virus, with some liposomes. Let's see how it works in the humanized mouse models, and then as a next step to bring this further into the clinic. And here I come to the end, and this is my group, and the support of our research comes from the DFG, the BMBF, Helmholtz, BIH, and also a private foundation that was really instrumental and very nice that